Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Light of the Valley. It is the fifth Sunday in Lent, which means already just in 1 week we will start Holy Week. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday. We start that journey once again towards that empty tomb. We get kind of a preview of that in today's lesson, but not just focusing on the physical aspect. Here we're going to hear about the raising of Lazarus, but also the other readings help show us the spiritual side of that as well. So we're going to espouse that through our readings and our hymns today. And if you see, our first hymn that we'll start out with is hymn number 520, Your Hand, O Lord, in Days of Old. So that's how we begin our worship today, by singing hymn 520. God bless you, worship.
Restore us, good Lord. Let your anger depart from us. Hear us, Lord, for your mercy is great. The Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, does not desire the death of sinners, but rather that they turn from their wickedness and live. Therefore, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. During these days of Lent, let us implore God to give us renewal and his Holy Spirit.
O Lord, my God, I call to you for help, and you answered me. I thank you for the love you have shown me in Jesus Christ, my Savior. Through him you have rescued me from the guilt of my sin and given me the peace of forgiveness. Help me fight against temptation, correct whatever wrongs I can, and serve you and those around me with love and good works. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord. Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. First reading for today comes from Ezekiel chapter 37, verses 1 to 14. On first glance, it would seem like this is where they get it from the Old Testament, that there's a resurrection from the dead, but there's other passages for that. This is a very vivid picture, a vision that's given to Ezekiel. And because it's a vision, we understand it symbolically. And what it's really referring to in this point in time of Ezekiel, while the people have been exiled to Babylon, away from their homeland, away from the land of promise, God would yet restore them. God would yet bring them life. Let's hear now the vision from Ezekiel chapter 37. The hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, Son of man, can these bones live? I said, O sovereign Lord, you alone know. Then he said to me, Prophesy to these bones and say to them, Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I put breath in you, and you will come to life. Then you'll know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them. There was no breath in them. Then he said to me, Prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, This is what the sovereign Lord says. Come for the four winds, O breath, and breathe into these slain that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them. They came to life and stood up on their feet, a vast army. Then he said to me, Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, Our bones are dried up and our hope is gone. We are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, This is what the sovereign Lord says. O my people, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and bring you up from them. I will put my spirit in you, and you will live. And I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken, and I have done it, declares the Lord. This is the word of our Lord. Second reading comes from Romans chapter 8, verses 11 to 19. Thinking of that spiritual resurrection, Paul in this section of Romans kind of brings both the physical and the spiritual together. Physical in that we die to sin. And we can't live in it any longer. We live a new life because the Spirit has come into us and made us alive spiritually. And so even if we suffer physically in this body, that suffering will come to an end. And the glories that await us, they compare nothing to the physical suffering we have here on earth. Let's hear now what Paul writes in Romans chapter 8. And if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through His Spirit who lives in you. Therefore, brothers, we have an obligation, but it is not to the sinful nature, to live according to it. For if you live according to the sinful nature, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. Because those who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive a spirit that makes you a slave again to fear, but you received the Spirit of sonship, and by Him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit Himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in His sufferings in order that we may also share in His glory. I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. The creation waits in eager expectation for the sons of God to be revealed. This is the word of our Lord. Please stand for the reading of the gospel. Our gospel today comes from John chapter 11, verses 1 to 45, and these words will serve as the basis of this morning's sermon. We hear. Now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped His feet with her hair. So the sister sent word to Jesus, Lord, the one you love is sick. When He heard this, Jesus said, This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it. Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. When He heard that Lazarus was sick, He stayed where He was 2 more days. Then He said to His disciples, Let's go back to Judea. The rabbi, they said, A short while ago the Jews tried to stone you, and yet you're going back there? Jesus answered, Are there not 12 hours of daylight? A man who walks by day will not stumble, for he sees by this world's light. It is when he walks by night that he stumbles, for he has no light. After He had said this, He went on to tell them, Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I'm going there to wake him up. His disciples replied, Lord, if he sleeps, he'll get better. Jesus had been speaking of his death, but His disciples thought He meant natural sleep. So then He told them plainly, Lazarus is dead, and for your sake I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him. Then Thomas, called Didymus, said to the rest of the disciples, Let us also go, that we may die with him. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus said to her, Your brother will rise again. Martha answered, I know he'll rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? Yes, Lord, she told him. I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who was to come into the world. And after she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. The teacher is here, she said, and is asking for you. When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who had been with Mary in the house comforting her noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. Where have you laid him? He asked. Come and see, Lord, they asked. They replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, See how he loved him?
But some of them said, could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying? Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there's a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days. Then Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. When he had said this, Jesus called out in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out! The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, take off the grave clothes and let him go. Therefore, many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary and had seen what Jesus did put their faith in him. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Invite the children to come up for a children's message. Something very specific. Jesus crying. What are some of the things that make you cry? Like, yeah, somebody passes away. Yeah. Yeah, what things make you sad, though? What are things that make you sad? If a pet dies, yeah, that would be sad. Anything else make you guys sad? Make you cry? How about if someone makes fun of you? Yeah. Or if somebody punches you?
No,
that's not the right answer, though. Nope, not good. Don't respond violence with violence. Nope. That's bad. No, that's the thing. Well, the whole thing is there are things in life that make us sad. It might be the death of someone. It might be someone we know, we care about, we love. It might be an animal. It might just be things that people say to you, like if someone yells at you or makes fun of you. It might just be if someone even hurts you physically. We hear today that Jesus cried. God cried. He cried because his friend Lazarus had died. He cried because he saw so many people who were so upset that Lazarus had died. But here's the thing. That same Jesus, who is our God, who cried, he also promises that one day I'm going to wipe every tear from your eye. I'm going to make it so that nothing sad ever happens again. He did that by rising from the dead. And he says, one day you are going to live with me forever. Never to experience any of this sadness ever again. I wipe every tear from your eye. So even our God who cried, he says, I'm one day take those tears away so that you'll never be sad again. So let's thank God for that. Let's fold our hands, bow our heads, and let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you for living for us and then conquering death by rising from the dead and promising that you would wipe every tear from our eyes. Thank you for bringing us all the joy and happiness we have every day. And thank you for all the future joy you will yet bring. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You guys can head back to your folks. Thanks for coming up this morning. We're going to continue by singing our next hymn. It's hymn 110, My Song is Love Unknown. Hymn 110. Thank you.
Standing or a little plaque with your name. It's got a nice little date on there for your birth, and then there's a blank space yet to be filled in. Stare at that plate and you realize one day there are going to be numbers there. A date. Day you die. Something I don't think we like thinking about. That's why we push off the funeral planning, why we try to postpone this idea of buying a plot, or maybe we just don't like that idea at all. Maybe there's something else. We're just going to let the kids decide when they're old enough what they're going to do with our remains, because we're not going to care. We're not going to be around anymore. But you don't need to just stare at your gravestone to face your mortality. We face it every single time we get sick. Every single time our body does not function the way that it should function, every time that you hear of someone being diagnosed with cancer, every time you have an ache and a pain where you know just your body isn't the way it should be. And then one day you know it'll be no more. What do you do when you face your mortality? For Mary and Martha, they look to Jesus. It seemed like the obvious place to go. I mean, Mary and Martha, they knew Jesus. They had hosted Jesus and his disciples. Mary had poured perfume on Jesus, wiped Jesus' feet with her own hair. They loved Jesus. And they knew that Jesus loved them. So it makes sense to send word to him. Go and say, Lord, the one you love is sick. Because Jesus can do something about this. When Jesus receives that message, though, his response was,
Yet when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was for 2 more days. Now, there wasn't instant communication back then, but think if Mary and Martha knew that. Think about what had to run through their mind the longer it took for Jesus to arrive as they saw their brother Lazarus getting sicker and sicker and then, in fact, dying. And still no Jesus, no word from Jesus. They don't know if he's going to come at all. You kind of imagine the excuses that might start to play in their heads. Well, you know, he's a really busy guy. And then knowing Jesus, he has to have a really good excuse for not being here for us. Try to give him the benefit of the doubt. But then Lazarus died. Still no Jesus. A couple days go by. Still no Jesus. Maybe we should have put our faith somewhere else. Have you spent time waiting for God to come and heal you? When you've been facing your mortality, when you've been facing these moments where your body isn't working the way it's supposed to be working, when you're in fact facing death itself, have you felt like God was just too busy to come and see you? It just seems like he's delayed. The longer it seems that God gets delayed when we're facing our mortality, we're praying for him, asking to come and help us, the more we get to that point where we start to question, God, do you say you care, but do you? Because if you cared, and I know you can heal this, I know you have power over life and death, why not answer this prayer immediately? Why not come right away? Why are you waiting? In fact, it was just this last week, catechism class, we do that with the teens on Tuesday nights, we looked at an atheist argument. Why does he not believe in God? Why does he think any rational thinking human being would not believe in God? And he says it's because, just think about these amputees in the world, these Christian amputees who pray for healing, and yet never once is there a recorded event of an amputee regrowing a limb because of prayer. Now, that was a whole hour plus long lesson. We're not going to get into everything he said. But basically, long and short of this, there were prayers by Christians for healing, and God did not answer it. That leads some people to say, well, obviously it's because he's not there. Obviously, it's because if this God were there, if he was so loving, he would do something. But he didn't. When you were praying for that healing and God was not coming, what did it do to your faith? Did you start to wonder, God, do you even exist? I spent all this time looking to you, asking for your help, and yet, where are you? Amazingly, as easy it would be to lose your faith in a time like that, as easy it is to question God and say, you know what, you have the capability of doing good and you're not using it, I don't even want to believe in you, yet, that was not the response of Mary and Martha. Jesus purposefully waited those days. That's what he tells us. And then when he did arrive there and he meets Martha, Martha even expresses, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now, he'll give you whatever you ask. Martha still believed that Jesus could do something about this. And her faith was very well placed. And we know how the story plays out. We know that, yep, Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. Just stop for a moment. A dead man was brought back to life. Have you ever seen such a thing? I haven't.
I've only ever heard about it, only ever heard stories, but to think in one moment that there's a person buried in a grave, and I mean, as much as we might want this person back, we could shout and we could scream and we could do whatever it is that we would want to do, and yet that person would never live. Jesus comes out and he says, Lazarus, come out, and the dead cells come back to life. Lazarus gets up, fully restored, fully healed, back to 100% health, and walks out of his own grave. I mean, that is just flat out absolutely amazing. It's obvious. So obvious that God, Jesus, has power, has mastery over death. So why'd you take so long? If you could have done that, Jesus, and in fact, we know from the other stories in the Bible, you could have just said those words, Jesus, where you were at, and Lazarus could have been healed right away. Why'd you wait? Because in that time, I questioned, I doubted, I may have even lost faith. Why wait? Well, actually, that's that whole section that gives us a few clues. Why wait? Because Jesus did that on purpose. He purposely stayed where he was for two more days after hearing that Lazarus was sick. He purposely did not pray right then and there, Father, make Lazarus well. And it would have happened. No, he waited. And he even said, when his disciples were questioning about going to visit him, when they didn't really understand the gravity of the situation, where he said, this sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it. I mean, from the first point, why wait? I guess you could just simply say, what's more miraculous? What's harder to do, to make a sick man well or to make a dead man come to life? No one can make a dead man come to life, and anyone except for Jesus. Thinking about that atheist who believes that because God has never, he's never seen someone pray and get healed, never seen an amputee get healed after a prayer. Just think, that same argument, if Jesus would have showed up and Lazarus got better, they'd say, his immune system kicked in. Jesus didn't do anything. It's just how the body works. So he waited until Lazarus was dead. But why make them wait 4 days? 4 days, to the point where Lazarus was in the grave. It was all done. Could have healed him right after. Well, the Jewish rabbis actually taught that the soul hovered over the body for 3 days after death. Didn't know that before. So, if you were a religious Jew, and Jesus had come back and raised Lazarus within those 3 days, they could rationalize it and say, well, you know, the soul decided to return to the body. That wasn't that hard to do. It could have done that. And that's why it came back to life. That's not all that impressive. So Jesus waited 4 days. 4 days so that Lazarus is dead, no chance of returning, absolutely not coming back. That's when Jesus comes. That's when Jesus arrives in Bethany. That's when Jesus goes up to Martha and says, your brother will rise. And Martha is thinking, well, I know that time has passed. He's in heaven now. So he'll rise on the last day. I know that truth. I believe it, Lord. And I'm so thankful for that. But that's to come. And he says, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me will live even though he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Lazarus had already died. So what's Jesus talking about? There was another big reason why Jesus waited 4 days. Waited till Lazarus had been in that tomb for 4 days before coming. Because Bethany was that close to Jerusalem, 2 miles. And in that time period, obviously we're well known, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, and all these Jews from Jerusalem come on down to Bethany, and they are with Mary and Martha. They are mourning right there with her, shedding the same tears because she's experiencing this loss. So Jesus, when he comes and he sees the tomb, he's deeply moved. He weeps himself. He's troubled. He's sad that everyone else is sad. He's sad because he knows this is a consequence of sin. People only die because they brought sin into this world. And it's horrific. It tears people apart. Then he said, remove the stone. Talk paths, protest. And he said, he prayed, Father, I thank you, you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me. But I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. So Jesus waited 4 days till Lazarus was completely dead by every standard, the body decaying, already starting to smell. Waited till the mourners had arrived, waited till they had crowded around Mary and Martha, had waited until they all came out together to that tomb, prayed out loud so that they could hear this, and then raises Lazarus from the dead. The result? Many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary and had seen what Jesus did put their faith in him. This story, this event in Jesus' life, this raising of Lazarus from the dead, is not just about the physical resurrection of one person. This is about the resurrection of a whole lot of people. This is about life coming to people who were dead. And not just physically speaking, yes, there is the truth. Jesus is going to raise us physically on the last day to restore our bodies and that we will live forever with him. But he also is the one who gives life spiritually. We come into this world and we are dead to sin. We are dead in our sins and our transgressions. And what can a dead person do? That's not a trick question. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. Lazarus' body would not respond to any of us saying, get up, come on, don't be dead anymore, just get out of that grave. It doesn't work. But Jesus, he is the resurrection and the life. He speaks words and they make dead things come alive. It's what he did when he created the world, that he took this dust. It wasn't alive, it's not living, but breathed into it the breath of life and became a living human being. Jesus spoke here to Lazarus and he came alive and walked out of his tomb. Jesus spoke to these Jews, they heard him. And they came alive. They believed in Jesus. They now saw he is the master over death. He is the resurrection and the life. Many people came to faith because Jesus waited 4 days to come and raise Lazarus. In the same way that those Jews were brought to life, same way that they were resurrected, it's happened for us. We've heard Jesus' voice. We've heard his words, and they have made us alive spiritually, taken us out of that death to sin and made us alive with Christ. But that doesn't take away what we know is yet coming. That gravestone is there in the future. It's got the date of birth. It's just waiting for the date of death. What do we do when we stare at our own mortality, stare at our own graves? I know we don't like planning for it, but think about this for a minute. Think about Jesus coming to Lazarus, coming to his tomb after 4 days, and speaking so that many people could come to faith in him. Not just to raise Lazarus physically, but to raise all those Jews who had come to mourn with Mary and Martha spiritually.
That gives us an opportunity that when that death date has to be filled in, well, what can I say at my funeral? What can be said that day? What Bible passages can I bring out that just show people what I've come to believe, that I know my Lord is the resurrection and the life, that I know His words make dead things come alive, and I know that if people hear these words, they can come to faith as I have come to faith. What Bible verses do that? What hymns do that? What else can I have in my funeral service that will tell people that, that will preach these words of life so that my funeral will not just be about death, but it will be about people coming alive by Christ's words? Maybe even something more than just planning that seems so nebulous, like just think about Bible passages and verses and hymns. Can you write an invitation list? Can you make a list of people that you know or that you're afraid that they're dead to Christ? That they're dead in their sins? That they have said, you know, that's your faith, that's fine, I don't believe it. Can you invite them to come to your funeral? Can you put that in your will? That these people, I want them to hear the words of the resurrection and life. I want them to hear Jesus' words on that day, because I'm going to already be with my Lord. I'm going to live. I'm going to live forever with Him. Can the people who come, can they hear the word of life and be made alive spiritually just as I was? Jesus asked Martha, after He said, I am the resurrection life. Whoever believes in Me will live even though he dies. Whoever lives and believes in Me will never die. Do you believe this? We do. Martha believed it. Mary believed it. We believe it. Because God has already raised us to life spiritually. So we know that even though we die, we will live with Him. Those same words that made us alive, that caused us to believe this, this will bring other people to spiritual life as well. How can you plan for that day? How can you plan to get to people the words of the resurrection and the life? He's the one who makes dead things alive. He is the one who is the master over death. He's the resurrection, and our life. Amen. Please stand. The peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. We'll continue our worship towards the bottom of page 10. God has made us His people through our baptism into Christ. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our Christian faith.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through Him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven and was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary and became fully human. For our sake He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day He rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
You may be seated. We'll continue our worship by gathering gifts and offerings to the Lord. Lutheran Church, I'll conclude each petition with the phrase, God of mercy, and then we'll all respond, hear our prayer. In this season of repentance and healing, we accept God's call to be mindful of the needs of others, offering our prayers on behalf of those in God's church and world. Blessed Lord, your heart has known the pain of grief and the sorrow of death, even as we know. You entered our world of death to take on the power of death and release those who live in its shadow. Receive our thanks for raising Lazarus from the dead, and direct our eyes to see in this miracle your own resurrection to everlasting life prefigured. Comfort us in our sorrows, and help us to grieve not as a people without hope, but as those who anticipate the resurrection of the dead and life everlasting. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious Lord, you honored the love and care within Lazarus's family, and you know the ties that bind as family, friends, and community. Fill the homes of your people with your spirit and with faith. Bless husbands and wives. Lead them to live in faithfulness to their marriage. Bless parents and the children you have placed in their care. Help us to live in love towards you, toward our family, and with our neighbor. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Mighty Lord, you hold all things in your hand, and you know the limitations of our power. Give us good and honest leaders in this and every land. Bless them with wisdom to heed your commands, honor the path of virtue, and punish the wrongdoer. Protect those who protect and defend us, especially the men and women in our armed forces. Guide us so that we may honor the sacred gift of life from conception until the end of this earthly pilgrimage. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Holy Lord, you have called and gathered to you a people through the voice of your word and by the power of your spirit. Give to all your people a strong faith in the face of temptation and in the face of doubt, and give them the wisdom to discern truth from error. Provide good and faithful pastors and church workers to serve your people in your name. Bless the churches throughout the world to make a common confession with us and serve together in the witness of your word and truth. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious Lord, you know the suffering of your people. You are present with us in our weakness. Give courage to the sick and those who suffer any need, that they may not waver from the truth. Give to our dry bones your healing grace and spirit, that we may be sustained in the day of trouble and delivered according to your merciful will. Hear us, for all whom we name in our heart before you. God of mercy, hear our prayer. And hear us, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Living Lord, you have promised to open the graves and raise your people to everlasting life. As we recall those who have gone before us, we cling to your promise and await that great and blessed day when you shall come in your glory to reunite heaven and earth and to finish your new creation and see you face to face. Rejoice with Lazarus, Mary, Martha, Ezekiel, and all the saints. Until that day, keep us in our baptismal grace and faith, so that we may be found blameless and ready when you come in your glory. God of mercy, hear our prayer. All these things, what else do you see that we need? Grant us, O God, for the sake of Christ, who died and rose again, and now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. We pray the prayer that you have taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, the night he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Same way, he also took the cup. After giving thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. To come forward to partake in the Lord's Supper. This is in keeping with our Lord's practice as outlined in 1 Corinthians chapters 10 and 11. If you have any questions about that practice, I'd be happy to speak with you after the service and share with you what we teach, preach, and believe here at Light of the Valley. So that the ushers will guide you up. God bless your communion.
Thank you.
Please stand. We'll sing the song of Simeon. You'll find it on page 14 of the worship folder.
Thank you.
thank you for coming out here on this Sunday morning and hearing about that life that God has given to us, how he's raised us from spiritual death to spiritual life, even as we look forward to that day where he physically raises us from the dead as well. Just know, we got lots of stuff kind of coming on, especially as we're getting closer to Holy Week. This week specifically, we have the Bible information class tonight at 6 p.m. That's for anybody interested in learning more about what our church teaches. We'll have on Monday night Women's Book Club at 7 p.m. We'll have our last midweek Wednesday night service. The soup and sandwich potluck starts at 6, and our last service is at 7 p.m., this time with the symbol of the purple robe, that Lenten symbol. And then Friday, we'll have our Seder, the Passover meal. Brenda talked about that last week. Do you want to say anything else this week, Brenda?
Money is due today. Sign up is due today. Money is due today.
So yeah, if you want to get in on that yet, just talk to Brenda here after church. And then just all the stuff we're getting ready. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday, and then we'll have a Maundy Thursday at 7 p.m., Good Friday at 7, and then back Easter Sunday, 10:30, with the breakfast starting at 9. If you want to invite people to that service, we have a whole bunch of extra postcards that are meant specifically for that purpose. You can grab them, take them along, invite them, and have them come on out. On that, you can see the rest of the announcements and act on them as you'd like. And then, of course, invite you to come on in and get some goodies after service here today. But do that after you take a little time to say hello to the people you worship with. And I'll get to the back, shake your hands, and wish you God's blessings on your week.